Okay, now we are going to have a talk which would cover two things. First of all, we would complete the introduction part of the discussion, so I will end up with what we were talking last class on the general intelligence and different ways which would lead us to the implementation of the artificial general intelligence, and along the way we will be making sense about different sorts of structures, graphs, and the symbolic languages which would make it possible to build the system with general intelligence. Before we move on, let's just recap the definition of the general intelligence. And it is like reaching complex goals in different complex environments using limited resources and minimizing the risks. So that's our definition, and this definition appears pretty technical. And if you think about this, you will find that actually the problem that we are going to solve here is the problem of optimization. And if you have optimization for very simple environment, then the system is not that general. So if you have, if the number of goals is equal to 2, if the number of different complex environments is equals to 2, if the complexity of the environment is low, and then if limitation of the resources is not that limited, and if there are just no more than 2 risks, different risks that we need to minimize, then we have kind of very little general intelligence. So it still have some complexity, it has some variety of the environments, it still has some limitation of the resources, and it has still to do some sort of risk mitigation problem solution, but that's all still not that general. And if you consider a human or some superhuman being or system, then the complexity and generality of the intelligence is increasing up to the skies. And somewhere in between are the systems that can be called narrow general intelligence. So the narrow general intelligence system is a system which can perform in somewhat complex goals, somewhat different complex environments, like all environments related to car manufacturing, or all environments corresponding to the car, car driving. Then we would talk about the narrow general intelligence, like if you have a robot then that can learn how to operate any car, but it cannot learn how to talk, or it cannot learn how to cook the dinner. Then that's kind of narrow general intelligence, because there is a generality, but it's not general enough to reach the human level of general intelligence. So that's one point. So, and during the most of the following talk, we will be talking about how to build the systems which have some sort of generality. And one of the properties of the system that would possess the general intelligence and the human level intelligence in particular is a consciousness. So the consciousness, as I told before in the previous talk, is a very vague term, so be careful with this term. And I will define it just here, just in order to have some frame of the some ground for the technical discussions about particular things. So let's define as consciousness as ability to build models of the environment based on the past and predict the future scenarios. But besides being able to build the models of the past and predicting the future, based on the past experiences. You should also be able to act consciously towards the desired ones. So that means that by consciousness we mean that we can not only make decision, but we make sense of these decisions when the decisions are being made. For example, you are operating the car, and you are operating the car in a kind of very comfortable environments, like there is a straight road in the field and there is no any cars on the road, and you drive this car and you have a friends in your car and you talk to friends, so you don't need to worry about the dogs, about the people, about the other cars, about the turns of the road. You just listen to the music, you can drink the water, you can eat some snacks, you can laugh, you can chat with your friends, and then the movements of your hands on the wheel and the movements of your leg on the gas pedal may be thought unconsciousness, because you are just operating the vehicle in simple conditions without of actually paying too much attention to it. But then imagine you have the complication of the situation. You see the road turn, you see the person approaching the road from one direction, you see the dog approaching the road from another direction, and you see the ongoing car coming in front of you. And then you need to actually start thinking hard before making any decision. So the first thing that you do here is you just tell your friends, shut up, just shut up, I need to make a decision in a few seconds. So the first you ask everyone else to shut up, so you focus on the car operation. And then you need somehow make a conscious decision to slow down. So in order to make better control over your vehicle in a complex road situation, you press the brakes, but you also control the speed which your leg is you control the power of your braking, because if you brake too fast, if you brake too powerfully, then your car may skid. So you need to brake carefully, and then along your braking, you also making decision where to turn the wheel. So you need to turn the wheel to avoid all the dangers, the people, the cars, the dogs, and also you need to make sure you turn the car in a way so you don't pass the road turns and you don't go into the tree or into the building. So then this part of your car operation is can be called consciousness. So another term to turn this kind of behavior is controlled. So you can say that acting in a controlled way, controlling your own movements or your own actions, can be property of consciousness, of conscious behavior. So again, you have an environment, and the environment is pushing some inputs to your body. And by your, I mean either you as a human or artificial system, hardware system, with some software that you put into the system. So if there is a system and the system is perceiving some inputs from the environment, and if there is a point where a system can make a decision and execute this decision based on the past experiences and the models on the future, on the models of the past applied to the future, then you can say that this system is acting consciously. Let's consider the example on this slide. Let's say we have very simple device or a being which has only one actor. It's anti-gravitational engine, and the only thing that the system or a being can do is either turn the gravitational engine on or turn the anti-gravitational engine off. And let's say there is some force And let's say at the beginning of the times, the system is just residing on the ground. And let's say that's a system just kind of a ball, and the ball has the anti-gravitational engine inside. And then there is some external power in the environment coming and just kicking this ball, and the ball is just starting to follow hyperbolic trajectory, so it raises in this up, and then it is going to fall down accordingly to the physical laws of the universe where this is all happening. And let's say the artificial being which is being involved here has some past experience. And that experience is that, okay, so if I'm getting up in the sky then and do nothing, then I eventually hit the ground and will feel pain. So in order to avoid feeling pain after being kicked into the sky, the person can make decision at particular point here in the middle of the screen. The person may just decide to turn the anti-gravitational engine on. And then when it turns anti-gravitational engine on consciously, it starts moving another trajectory. It flies into the skies. So it has consciously made a decision to execute particular program, behavioral program to prevent falling onto the ground. And then we can say that that was an act of conscious activity. Now let's consider another example. From the real life. Let me show you the video. So, what we have seen so far? So far, we have seen the example of what is called lifelong learning, and also that can be called example of the general intelligence. What do I mean? First of all, it's general intelligence because the person on this video is capable to do what is never experienced by people and in real life. So the people as a biological species were not evolved in order to operate the kite boards and kites and to ride these boards on the water powered by wind. So that has nothing to do with the path of the human evolution. So we can speculate that evolution prepared people to make fire, to build shelters, to hunt animals, to sew clothes, to extract nuts with stones, but not operating the kite boards and kites. On the other hand, the people are able to learn such a capabilities. So the people are able to invent the water kite boards, the people are able to invent kites, and the people are able to master themselves to how to ride on the water. And the problem that we, and so that one perspective. Another perspective is that this kind of trick can be learned by a person at a very late stage of the development. Like, for example, you can be 40 or 50 or even 60 years old before you start moving, before you start teaching what is shown on the given slides. So it shows that the system in that the human intelligence is general enough, so the person at late age can adapt to completely new and novel environments and master their skills in order to operate within this environment. Now let's look into the details of how you can learn this. So if you mentioned the video, it all appears like smooth. It all appears like there is one movement, the person turns, the person rolls, the person lands on the water, the person keeps moving in the opposite direction. It all appears like single trick, like single movement. But you never able to learn this particular artificial trick in such an artificial conditions in such a smooth way. There is no way to learn this. So there are just two different ways how you can learn this. The first way is that you actually write and you design the behavioral program. So, and this behavioral program for this particular case consists of four, I would say, operators or four statements in the behavioral program. So the first statement is that you need to push both legs and pull the right hand, and you need to do that at one time. And then the next instruction for the processor is that push left leg and push and pull both hands. And then the instruction number three is to pull left hand and look right. And the final instruction number four is pull right hand and bend both legs to absorb the landing. And the problem with learning this program is that if you do something wrong at any stage, you immediately crash and you have very bad feeling. So you can't learn this just by means of learning this incrementally. So you just can't. So all you can do is somehow write this program in the very beginning, and they keep executing this program till it completes in the very end. And if all this if the program completes at the very end, you get the positive feedback because you are safe, because you have made this trick, and because you have some endorphins injected into your blood. To make you to you feeling happy, but you need to do all four things right at right time. How to do that? The way number one is to write this program being able about the physics of this kind of media, of this kind of environment. So you need to have a good idea about the rules of the water, about the wind, about the aerodynamics of the kite that is pulling person in the air here, and having all that aerodynamics, hydrodynamics, and other laws of the physics in mind, or experience of these laws in your personal brain, you can design this computer program. By computer program, I mean that's a list of instructions, and every instruction needs execution. And on the first row, you can see these words or these instructions are written the way that instructors are communicating such instructors to the students. And by the way, so the first way, as I said, is to learn this movement is to write this program yourself, given your knowledge of the subject domain. And the second way is to have these instructions read from somewhere. Either there is an instructor which tells this order of instructions for you, or you just open a book and you read these instructions, or you just go to YouTube and the instructor on YouTube tells you the order of actions that you need to execute in order to have this move completed successfully. And if you want to have a robot which would be able to do this, and if you would like to design a robot which have legs, which have hands, and it can pull and push these hands and bend the legs and so forth, you would need to get it down to particular instructions, and these instructions may be written in form what is called predicates in computer science and in mathematical logic. So let's consider how we can have the human language instructions encoded by means of logical predicates. So in order to initiate the move, One second. Let me turn the phone off. Okay, I have turned the phone off. So first, so in order to initiate the move, you apply predicate push applied to right leg, predicate push applied to left leg, and predicate pull applied to right hand. And then these predicate, or these three predicates, can be actually translated into the signals that are directed to the respective legs or hands. Let's say the right leg and left hand and right hand are actuators, and the push and pull are actual mechanical states of these actuators which can be applied. Like if the push starts motors rotating in one direction, and pull starts motors rotating in the other direction. So your legs are, and hands, either bent or straightened. And then that would be the robot, right? So then at the next stage, you apply another predicates. You make these other predicates true, like push applied to the left leg, pull applied to the right hand and left hand, and so forth. And these are predicates that you can use to write this program down. Here you can see that again, you can learn the entire move by means of experiential feedback, but that is what is called global feedback. So if you study experiential learning and the cognitive architectures of the multi-agent systems, which we'll be talking about later, you will find that there are two different kinds of feedback. One feedback is called local feedback, and you get this feedback when you do something something right at a moment. Like, for example, the local feedback is when you learn, when you teach your car, your dog to bark. So, for example, you want to rise, you want to have your dog barking when you raise your hand. And immediately you raise your hand, and if the dog barks at the moment when you raise your hand, you give a feedback to a dog. You give a sugar to the dog, right? And the dog learns that whenever you raise the hand, it needs to bark. And that's a local feedback. But in this particular case, the, as I said, the local feedback is not possible. So you always have just only negative feedback at every stage, and the negative feedback may be severe and dangerous enough, so you may hurt so bad so that you won't be have intent to keep teaching this movement further. So it's better to design a way so you can only get what is called global feedback. And the global feedback is a case when you get the feedback only when a sequence of specific events or specific actions is completed. Like, for example, if you want your dog to take some subject and then bring this subject to your friend or your spouse or your wife or your husband or your mother, that's already a complex movement. So you may need first to train dog to get the object and bring it to yourself, and then you need to complicate the behavioral program. So instead of bringing the object to yourself, you need to retrain this dog to bring the subject to the person that you point your finger to, and then and then you get the feedback to the dog only after the second part of the program is executed. So that's called global feedback. So in this example, you can see that the process of learning may continue, like you feel upset after the first unsuccessful attempt, then you feel upset under when you have two phases of the program executed, and you still feel upset when you have three pieces of the program executed, and you get lucky only when all four stages are completed successfully. In order to write this program, you need to design a language. So, for example, if we are writing a handbook or scholar book for kite surfers, we would need to have a right language. So whenever an instructor writes a language in the same words, all students that are capable to recognize these words are capable to learn these movements in the same way. And at the upper side of this slide, we see what can be called ontology, underlying given subject domain, the lexicon, and the grammar that can be used to design our predicates that we use in order to describe the behavior in such case. So what could be the ontology for this domain? So first of all, there are four actions. The actions are look, pull, push, and bend. And we can call all these four guys as action. Then there are a bunch of nouns. And one noun is a direction, and another noun is body part. Then there are two different sorts of body part. One sort of body part is a hand, and another sort of body part is a leg. And finally, both hand and leg may be either left or right. And also the direction may be left and right. Note that both left hand and right hand are at the same hand, and at the same time either hand or leg, and either left or right. And finally, there is a time. And the time may have different timestamps. And these timestamps or values of the time may be either absolute, like particular world time seconds, accordingly to the Greenwich time or accordingly to the local time, or there may be just first, next, then, finally. So first, next, then, finally timestamps would or yesterday, now, tomorrow, right? So these are relative timestamps or relative times that still can be used for you to indicate the order of the sequence of events that are used to build your behavioral programs. Now, besides being a kind of something, arrows. So the arrows, the solid arrows here are arrows indicating kind of relationship. So look, pull, push, and bend are kind of action. Left hand and right hand are kind of hand and direction, either left or right, and so forth. But besides the kind of relationships on this ontology, we have the argument relationship. So the dotted lines, like here or like here, they are represent the argument relationship. For example, when you look, you have a direction where to look. When you pull, you have either a hand or so when you pull, you can pull only the hand. So we don't have, in this given ontology, we don't need to push the hands. So if there were a case when you need to push the hand, then we would have the arrow between push and hand. But in given world, in given environment, there is no need to push the hands. So that's just the rules of the environment. That's just the rules of the small world that we are talking about now. So pull applies only to hand. Push applies only to legs, and bend applies only to legs. So the leg can be bent or pushed, and the hand can be pulled. And that's all what we can do in this world about the legs and hands. And finally, the look has direction, the pull, push, and bend have either hand or leg, and that's all. So that's the what we call small world ontology, very small world, where just few number of actions, few possible nouns, and few possible argument relationships between the actions and the nouns. And then we can build the grammar for a language that would use let us to describe any possible behavior in such a world. So any language statement would be about a predicate or a verb describing the particular action, and then the first argument of the this predicate would be the object which would serve the which is actually the subject of the action, and then there is adverb, and in particular this adverb argument is used to represent the time. So you see the arrow from the time to adverb position, you see the arrow from the noun to object position, and you see the action arrow to the verb position. So what we have done so far on this slide, we just designed the ontology, which is about the relationships between different concepts. We have the lexicon, which is about all the possible words that we can use in our language. And we have designed the grammar, which follows very simple pattern of a verb, then opening parentheses, then object, then comma, then adverb, and then closing parentheses. And you, if you look at the comments or instructions below, you will see we have the behavioral program written completely in terms of this language. Well, unfortunately, we have another omission on the ontology. There is a greater relationship. So in order to encode the sequence of events, the saying that this is coming before this, we also need to apply the predicate greater, which applies to times only. So on the ontology above, there would be a greater balloon, and this greater balloon would have connections to time. We're having the time both first and second arguments, so the greater predicate would let us figure out which timestamp or time absolute or absolute timestamp or relative timestamp which of them is sooner or later than the other one. Other than that, we have completely used the designed ontology and lexicon and grammar to describe this behavioral schema. So now we can just design the mechanical part, and we can put this program into the some imaginary processor which is able to process the predicates and results of and transmit the results of predicates to the actuators and engines of the robot, and the robot would do just this sort of trick. Now, coming further, we can imagine that given the same functionality and given the same motors and the same environment and the same physical actions executed in the same environment, using the same motors or same actuators or same sensors, we could invent multiple languages and multiple ontologies, and we can invent multiple ways to write these programs. For example, you can replace parentheses with brackets, or you can use exclamation marks instead of semicolons, right? Or you can use semicolons instead of commas. So you may change the syntax, you may change the patterns, or you may just write arrows instead of opening bracket. And there will be like arrow between the push and the right leg and T1. So the first thing that we can amend is the syntax. The another option and possibility how we can make this implemented in different ways is about having different system of relay objects and the relationships of the objects in the ontology. For example, you can have predicates like push with and right leg and time, or a left leg and another time, but there will be just two arguments in every predicate. But you may design different ontology. You may design ontology like this one, but just remove the left hand and the right hand here. So you may just remove these right hand, left hand nodes, right leg and right leg, and left leg and right hand and left hand nodes. All these nodes could be just removed. But if you remove them, you still need somehow to tell the system that it needs to pull the left leg or right hand. And to do so, you need to create more complex predicate structure. So you have the push to become a predicate with three arguments. And the first argument indicates whether the leg or hand is left or right. The second argument would indicate whether that's a leg or a hand. And the third argument would indicate the time when the action is happening. So as long as your engine and the actual wiring of the of your system, your sensors and actuators of the of your artificial system or your robot are designed to are designed to deal with ontology of the first kind or ontology of the second kind, or there is a way to translate the statements in ontology of the first kind into the statements of the ontology of the second kind, you can choose any language and ontology design that you want. Another possibility to do variation of the your language and that you use to describe this is about replacing use of multi-argument predicates with using higher order predicates. For example, let's say we don't want to be time as a part of predicate in order to align the sequence of events into the chain sequence. Like instead of having time associated with every action and indicating the relationship between the timestamp with greater predicates, we would just group particular actions with logical predicate. Like for example, we can say that pushing right leg, pushing left hand, and pulling right hand may be happening and at one time as single unit, and we use AND predicate, which bundles all these elementary predicates together. And then we have another higher order predicate, which says that something on the left in this predicate argument structure is happening before than something on the right in the second position of the before argument structure. And then you, instead of writing four blocks or four statements or four blocks of actions for every moment of time and group them by time, you can write just three groups of before transitions where the beginning of the transition is followed by the ending of the transition, and then the ending of the prior transition is given becoming the beginning of the second transition. And then the second transition and outcome ending part of the second transition becomes beginning part of the third transition. So you write, and in this case, on the two examples above, you are describing your behavioral schema in terms of states. So what you do at particular time, and below you describe this in terms of the transformations. So you transform from this state to another state, and you transform from this state to this state, and then you transform from this state from this state. So which way is better may depend on your taste, style, hardware requirements, performance optimization reasons, and so forth. And here is one more way to write it in different way. You can this at some point you may decide that I don't want to have a system that have predicates with more than one argument, because you may just have we'll talk about the hypergraphs and graphs later, but there are some can, for example, if you want to write system in the your rule system in the SQL database, then every multi-argument predicate would be corresponding to a record in the SQL table. Like, for example, we can for writing the logic in the form of the first row, then we would just design a table which would have which we would be called action, and the and the first column in this table would be action type, the second column in the table would be action leg, and the third column in the table would be action time. So you would have SQL table column or table of three columns. Also, there may be column number four for ID and so forth, but you would use SQL database our server out of the box in order to program this. But for example, imagine you have a graph database, and you have a graph database which doesn't have type for the link. We'll be talking about the different sorts of graphs on the next class, but the idea is that let's say you want all your predicates have no type, and let's say you have all your predicates having just two arguments. So let's say you just want to have only left and right arguments in the predicate, and no any predicates having any type. So just binary links, what we call binary untyped links. So, and if you want to record the same using these binary untyped links, you need to introduce internal variables. Like internal variable A would be about associating the pushing, the right legness, and T1-ness. The variable number B would associate pushing, left legness, and T1-ness. And variable number, variable called H would associate pulling, left handing, and T3-ness. And the predicate connecting different types, type times will be just indicating the sequential order of the times, saying like that T2 after comes after T1, and T3 comes after T2, and T4 comes after T3. So that would be possible, and we could do it in that way. And finally, we can make it even more complex, adding the values or probabilities to every statement. For example, it may be known that if you consider such a behavioral schema for starting the movement, like push right leg, push left leg, and push right hand, it may happen that some of the parts of this schema are more important than others. That means if you don't pull the right hand, you always screw everything. So it is a must, so you have the pull in the right hand as part of this movement. But pushing right leg and left leg may be not that important. So if you don't do this pushing right leg and pushing left leg, if you don't do it right, and if you don't screw up things further, then there is some probability that you will be still lucky in the very end. So we put less probability or less importance to some of the predicates. And so we can apply it to the same. And then you can also use different grammatical designs. You can use different syntax patterns that you can follow to encode these probabilities. For the first block of statements, you have no probabilities expressed at all. In the second block of examples, you make the probabilities encoded in such angle brackets. And that would be the language of how you do that. And in the third design, you would have the probability just another argument of a predicate. And that also would be fine as long as you handle this in your language interpreter and command system executing this language consistently. The good question is what kind of the language and what kind of ontology and what kind of the argument structure you use when you deal with predicates. Here is the chart, which shows that all possible designs are possible. Like on the very right, you have the predicates with many arguments. Like for any sort of action, you create the predicate where you have any number of arguments that you have. It's like pull, right, hand, and time. And on the left, you have another extreme case when you just have everything encompassed with links, where every link has no type and it just connects two different points or two different vertices in your graph. So in the left, in the case on the left, you don't need any ontology to express the meaning of the particular structures in your system, because everything is just about the links, and links have no types and links have no meanings. On the right, you have what is called domain ontology. So the domain ontology is a way to structure your knowledge about the world in the particular concept. Like for example, if you have an SQL table which has a customer, it has a seller, it has a store, it has an invoice, it has an invoice item, that's the domain ontology. And often the structure of the SQL tables for any business application actually mimic the domain ontology of the particular area. And the reality is that the systems that are based on the domain ontologies are the most efficient in terms of runtime performance. So you can write very efficient code, you can optimize your indexes in your SQL table, you can tune the performance of the table using carefully written SQL queries, but the system will only work if it works accordingly to the structure of the design of this domain ontology. And if you want, for example, just imagine example, you have the design the system to, for a store, to operate the store with product, with invoices and tables and so invoices, customers and invoice items and checks and payments and so forth. And now let's say that you want this system to reuse this system in order to operate the car. Of course it won't work. Of course, the tables that are suitable to operate with the car, with the sales in the store, won't fit the actions that are needed to operate the car. And the systems that are on the left, where you don't use any predefined predicate structure or database structure, where you have only the links, that systems of that kind are the most flexible. So if you have something new, you just add another bunch of links. And the system still keeps working. You add the links that are describing the car operation. You can add links describing the logic of the kiteboarding operation or bicycle operation. And you still have the same system. You don't need to redesign it. But the problem on the left solution is that because every single object is described by bunch of links, that becomes not very efficient in terms of runtime performance. And in the middle, we have systems which can be thought as in between, and the systems are pretending to be able to operate with limited number of typed predicates. Like for example, we define a basic ontology which has the links of inheritance type, So you can use this link to describe that X is kind of A and Y is kind of B, and that's inheritance link. You can have specialized link types that describe the part of relationship. So you can write down that M is part of K and Q is part of P. And also you can have the special kind of link or predicate to describe the temporal or causal relationship. Like you can write that T1 is happening before the T2, or you can write that the rain is happening before the grass is getting wet. Or you can write that the sound is coming before the bullet. Sorry, the bullet is coming before the sound, and the lightning is coming before the thunder sound. And there are different sorts of such designs of the universal or foundational ontologies that can be further used to describe the domain ontologies, but not in terms of fixed database tables, but in terms of flexible systems of typed links types, of typed universal link types like inheritance, part of, before, and cause. And the examples of such ontologies are cycle, freebase, atom space, schema org that I mentioned when we were talking about the coursework, and they have different pluses and contras, and we'll be talking about this later. So whether you want to have very efficient in time in on runtime, but very bound to a domain system, you go to the right. And if you want to have very flexible system, but you need to have a lot of memory and computing resources to handle that, you go on the left. And if you are somewhere in between, you have a lot of space in the middle of this chart. Now, what are the possibilities of handling the knowledge stored in such form of predicates, or ability to learn this knowledge from the experiential learning and storing this knowledge in forms of such predicates? There are three systems known to myself so far, and I am pretty sure there are no well developed systems in the world that perform better than the three systems presented here. And the system number one is a so-called non-axiomatic reasoning system designed and implemented by Pei Wang and his colleagues, and it's called NARS, and it's open source. And if you can download it and you can play it, and for example, you can use NARS system in order to solve the problem of the experiential learning that I've been talking about when presenting the coursework. Another case of this, another system historically is the logical prediction system called Discovery, and it has been designed and implemented by Evgeny Vityaev and his colleagues. And Evgeny Vityaev is a resident of Novosibirsk, and there is a possibility that some of you have been attending his classes. And this program is not open source, but if you are a student of Evgeny Vityaev, then you probably can do something about doing some work with this system. And finally, another system which is called Probabilistic Logic Networks, or PLN. That is system being maintained and implemented by Ben Gerzel and his colleagues. And it's pretty much resembling non-axiomatic reasoning system NARS by its principles, but it just have different implementation. And the basic principles of this system are implementing probabilistic logic. So some people call it probabilistic logic, some people call it non-axiomatic logic. The difference between probabilistic logic and fuzzy logic and non-axiomatic logic is more about philosophy and more about using particular formula or particular interpretations that inference in such a system has, but the idea of all of these kinds of logic is the same. So plain logic is about true or false. Either I like this girl or I dislike this girl. Either I pull my hand or I push my hand. So that's about true or false. But the systems described above are about making these decisions soft. Like I may like this girl to give an extent, or I may pull my hand a little, but not that hard. Or there is a probability that I need to pull my hand, or there is a possibility that this girl likes me, but I don't know that for sure. So all these sorts of perceptions or actions may be not evaluated not with a fixed or strict Boolean logic, but they may be implemented with a soft, fuzzy, probabilistic or non-axiomatic logic. We'll talk about this more about on the next slide. But before we move to that, there are four typical kinds of operations that can be applied to the knowledge stored in the form of predicates, like we discussed it. So the operation number one is revision. So what is revision? Revision is like you observe the weather, and whenever you see a cloud, dark cloud, you see the rain. Every day, whenever there is a dark cloud on the sky, you see the rain in a few minutes. So you have multiple experiences day over day, and you use revision operation in order to aggregate these experiences and come to conclusion that always, whenever there is a dark cloud, there is a rain afterwards. Or whenever there is a bad nutrition, the immune system of a human is weakened and the human may get sick. So that's revision rule. Another rule which is implemented in such a system is a deduction. And the deduction is a typical way to connect the pieces of knowledge that may be not obvious, but having knowledge about that these two items are connected may help you to make your decisions. Like, for example, on this slide, from the medical domain, you may learn that the weakened immune systems cause the infection. In the food physiology domain, you can learn that bad nutrition cause weakened immune system. So far, these two pieces appear unimportant. Okay, so I have a bad nutrition, so I have weakened immune system, so what? I don't care. Weakened immune system doesn't prevent me going to the bars, right? On the other hand, if you have extra knowledge about the weakened immune systems, like weakened immune system making increasing the probability of getting infection, makes it possible for you to connect that bad nutrition at some point may affect in infection you get at a later point. And you connect these pieces of knowledge using the deduction link. And you infer deduction operation, and the deduction operation lets you to have a link between the bad nutrition and infection. And so if you don't want to get infected, then you need to eat more vegetables and eat less junk food. And now there are two other typical operations that are called induction and abduction. So induction is about connecting multiple causes like weakened immune system and the cold with some probability asserting that some of the outcomes of the initial premise are connected somehow. So you may get cold because of having your immune system weakened, and you may make this guess because of the facts. So you have the facts that the bad nutrition was causing cold, and bad nutrition was called weakened immune system according to the medical analysis results, and you may derive the conclusion that the cold may affect immune system, or the other way around, that weakened immune system was causing a cold. So that's just a guess, but this guess has to be confirmed with some extra observations. And another kind of guess is the opposite guess, is that you try to find the causal relationships based across two different premises or preceding states from the ending state. Like, for example, if you see observation that infection is caused by being cold and infection is caused by weakened immune system, again, you can guess that getting cold may have some relationship to weakened immune system, which may be true or not. In order to have the predicates to have some meaning, there are a few different ways how you express that probabilistic or fuzzy or uncertain meaning for the links between different facts. And the interesting approach to this is implemented in the NARS and probabilistic logic network systems, and this approach is based on what is called compound truth value, where every truth value is aggregating two different numbers. One of them is called strength and one of them is called confidence, and these numbers can be inferred from the amount of evidence. Let's consider the case on this slide. Let's consider that we have the knowledge inferred from the different source of observations found in the medical records in the hospital. And let's say there are 6 of 10 medical records saying that the bad nutrition was causing cold, and there are 60 of 100 medical records saying that the bad nutrition was causing the infection. In the case, in both of the cases, we have the same strength. The strength is low. So 60 of 100 is 60% and 6 of 10 is 60%. So the strength of such a causal relationship would be low. However, the confidence of the reliability of this relationship is different, because here you have 100 observations and here you have just 10 observations. So in the case above you have the high confidence, but in the case above you have the low confidence. Another example. Let's say that 9 of the 10 records indicate that bad nutrition is causing weakened immune system. So the strength is high, but the confidence is low because there are just 10 records. Another example. 90 of 100 records point out that the weakened immune system is causing infection. And then again we have the high strength, but we also have the high confidence because 100 is more than 10. So let's imagine we want to design and build a system which operates accordingly to the ideas that we were talking before. But before we talk about this system, let's have a little bit more discussion about the nature of what we mean by consciousness. And let me get back to the example of the car operating. So when you start learning how to operate the car, every move of your hand or a leg or a head on the road is conscious. So in order to start the engine, you need to learn, okay, first I pull the brake, then I turn the key, then I pull the handle in the drive direction, and then I release the brake, and the car starts moving, and then I need to start steering, and then in order to increase the speed of the car, I need to start pressing the gas pedal. And that's becomes that's the program told to you by instructor. So what is the order of starting the car? But eventually, when you master this, it becomes unconscious, because you know this so well, you have done this so many times, that you actually can speak over the phone, and you can speak with your friends, getting in the car at the same time, and you can still turning the key, pressing the brake, moving the handle, as long as you speak. Okay, however, when you are in a complex road environment and you have a lot of pedestrians and ongoing cars on the road, you still need to stop talking and focus on the road and make hard decisions based on your controlled and conscious experience and behavior. However, if you become a taxi driver, which is avoiding pedestrians and ongoing cars 10 or 8 hours every day, it becomes not a problem to operate even the downtown in a car in downtown of a city, still being able to talk with passengers on the voice, talk with the wife on the phone, and sending SMS messages as long as you drive through the crowd of people on the street. And you don't, because your reflexes and your systems are so adapted to it, so you don't need to focus your attention on such usual and non-novel thing as a extra pedestrian or extra car. you just used to it. You just have this somewhere, you will be all the driving operation experiences hardwired in your consciousness. Another example with this kind of sport movements. When sportsmen learn this kind of events, they need to execute this program step after step, as I have been talking earlier. But once you master this, once you are able to complete this transition of four stages successfully a few hundred times, you don't need to focus on this program anymore. You have made this program hardwired into your subconsciousness. But then you can move on to the another level of complexity. You can start participating in competitions. And the competitions, the judges on such a sporting competitions are making judgments not on the quality of single trick like this. They qualify participants of the competitions based on the complexity of multiple tricks. So you need to do one turn, one jump, another turn of another kind, another turn of the fourth kind, and some other movements like snowboarders or skiers do on the Olympics. And but then every trick, like single trick on this screen, becomes an element of the higher order program. So the sportsmen start writing the program not in terms of movements being part of particular trick. They are writing the programs in terms of sequence of tricks. And even further, they are writing the programs in terms of a sequences of tricks, like where every trick hasn't become a predicate on itself. Like you may take the dual transition, or you can make triple transition. So when you jump, you decide whether you need to turn around two times in a row, or you need to turn three times in a row. So then the single element of the program becomes the predicate on itself. And then you can build your behavioral programs with higher order predicates. Like, for example, instead of thinking about starting the car as pressing the brake, pulling the handle, and then releasing the brake and pulling the gas, you start not thinking about such level of details. You start thinking about just start the car. and that becomes the symbol or a predicate on itself, and you can use these symbols like start the car, stop the car, move on to the highway, pull away from the highway as single units of actions involving speeding up or slowing down and turning left or right, depending on the rules of the road in a given country. So, when this is happening in an imaginary brain, human brain or artificial system brain, it gets down that there are different levels of abstractions in terms of what is called cognitive architecture. So the cognitive architecture is a modern term which lets you design a system which is capable for cognitive behavior. So software architecture is about building the software, building your design of your software into the units, writing, implement, designing the interfaces and the APIs to these units, arranging the data flows between these units of your software design. But building intelligent systems is about building cognitive architectures where different layers or different components are responsible for different operations. And we are talking about different operations in terms of cognitive science. We are talking about different level of abstractions. And here is a concept, one of the concepts of how you can structure the your neurophysiological experience in terms of the cognitive architecture. Like at the very bottom level here, you see the fine-grained activity of the single neuron in terms of synaptic chemical channels of the synaptic transmission or micronemus inside of the single neuron body. At a higher level of abstraction, you have the neural networks, and the neural networks which are about operating at the level of the individual neurons connected to other individual neurons. Further, you have what can be called as a neural clusters or neural columns in neurophysiology, but in the works of Marvin Minsky, describing the cognitive processes in terms of abstract notions of his own cognitive architecture. It is called chi lines, chi trees, which underlie some features or properties of the objects being involved in the higher level of abstractions. And in the higher level of abstractions, at the semantic networks level, you build the semantic relationships between the objects assembled from the fine-grained features on the lower layer. For example, if the lower level is about the features of the animals like fur, mewing, walking, tail, waving the tail, then on the higher level of the semantic network you deal with specific objects like cats, dogs, cats chasing the dog, the dogs chasing the cats chasing the mouse. So the chasing is the relationships and eating is the relationship. So cat is eating the mouse and eating is a semantic relationship, and dog is chasing the cat, where the chasing is a semantic relationship, and cat, dog and the mouse are the concepts in these semantic networks. At the higher level of abstraction, there are scenes or what is called frames or what is called experiences. Different scientists have different words for that, and that assembles particular combinations of the objects and relationships between them into the scenes or particular impressions, like a dog is chasing a cat in a city, or a tiger is eating the rabbit in the forest. So that's each of these two is just a picture or some impression which may appear multiple times in your life. And at the higher level, there are what is called transformations or transformers or transframes, where you have a change in a transition between different frames, like tiger was chasing the rabbit, and then tiger was eating the rabbit, and then tiger was going to sleep because it has satisfied, it has suppressed his hunger by means of eating the rabbit, and so it can fall asleep. So that's transformations between different aesthetic impressions or states. And finally, there is a narrative stories. It's the highest level of abstraction where you assemble the single movement or single story, like the hunt. The hunt is a process of tiger chasing the rabbit, then tiger catching the rabbit, then tiger eating the rabbit, and then tiger going to sleep because of the hunger being satisfied. And that's a narrative story. And what is interesting here is that you can apply this kind of design for every the specific layer or any specific kind of perception. Like, for example, if you have sensory inputs, then you have one number of layers for your visual. If you have visual perception, you can have one hierarchy of visual of such such layers. If you have audio perceptions, you have another hierarchy of such layers. If you combine audio and visual data, you can have another level of complexity and another hierarchy of that kind. And the design of Marvin Minsky, described in this in his Society of Mind book, describes that any complex cognitive behavior may be implemented by a hierarchy of the individual agents or intelligent subcomponents, each of where each of them is specialized for a specific action. For example, let's say there is a cognitive program of driving the vehicle. So the program of driving the vehicle is built of the system of subprograms or agents, steering agent, braking agent, gas controlling engine, door opening agent, wheel changing agent, motor engine fixing agent. So all of these agents are responsible for specific kind of operations, and there are higher level agents, like, for example, agent responsible for car speed. But the agent responsible for high speed is responsible, is all has two different subordinate agents. One of them is braking agent associated with left leg, and another agent is a speeding agent, which is associated with the gas pedal. And but there is another higher order agent responsible for the entire process, like the agent which controls speeding agent, speed control agent, and steering agent, and handle changing a speed handle changing agent, which is responsible for changing the handle either into the drive or neutral or reverse. And another property of such a systems is that there are two different kinds of learning that can be implemented in such systems. So let's consider just one kind of activity, learning some trick, as on the video on the beginning of this talk, or learning to drive the car. There are two ways how you can learn this. The first way is what is called symbolic learning, and that's let me make sure where is the left and the right. Symbolic learning, and it happens at the very top level. So at the very top level, it means that you operate with higher concepts, like, for example, pressing, pulling the leg, and pulling the right leg, right hand, and pushing the both hands at once. that's kind of element, that's kind of symbol, that's kind of sign that can be explained to others. So the narrative story is about I'm turning right and then braking afterwards. You can explain this in terms of language. So at the higher level, you can explain what you are doing. But it takes a long time to think about that. It takes long to make decision based on that. So if you operate the car in terms of if I turn the wheel to right, I will turn right. And if I press, and then okay and I need to turn right, so I turn the wheel right, and I control my turn to the right by means of adjusting the angle of my wheel with the angle of my car. If you want to operate the car by kind of speaking aloud in such a way, you shouldn't go with high speed, right? Because if your car is moving with a speed of 200 kilometers, you won't be able to speak to yourself about turning the wheel to right or left. You will hit the tree or house or person on the road. So when you learn to operate the car in such a controllable or explainable or symbolic or semantic way, you should be doing this slowly, because you would be able to make the decisions only in a very slow way. However, when you master that, you go down, you can experientially, you can train your muscles, your low-level neural network responsible for movement control somewhere in the spinal cord, and then you can make decision much more faster, because the neural signals shouldn't go to the logical segments of your cortex. You don't need to verbalize your actions, but your perceptions are just directly transmitted to your actions. And so at the lower level, there is a thinking fast. So you can make decisions faster. So once you learned how to operate your car on the high speeds, you can go up to 100 and 200 kilometers an hour, depending on the quality of the road, and you don't need to worry about speaking aloud whether to turn your wheel right, to turn right, and or to turn it to left, to turn left. However, on this lower level of perception and action, the explanation is suffering. So if you are operating the car at 200 kilometers, and then you see a rabbit or a dog jumping out from the curb in front of your vehicle, you may avoid the collision. But then when you avoid the collision, you would never be able to explain to yourself what was the actual decision that you made. You just made something very quickly based on your past experiences hard-coded in your neural networks deep inside without of any reasonable explanations, and you just did something subconsciously avoiding the collision, but you are not able to explain that. So that is, systems of subconsciousness intelligence are making you to make fast decisions, but they are hard to explain. And the systems that are capable for explanation and learning by means of linguistic means or using some explicit or implicit language controlling the action are capable to think only in a slow way. So that means that if you want to cite say what is your goal and what is your expected architecture, you need to look at this slide or similar kind of slide and decide what are your business cases. So if you don't have a business cases for explanation, but you need have lots of business cases for making fast decisions, you can take this. But you need also to remember that such a systems that behave at subconscious level, they also need a lot of learning. And it is known that in order to train neural network, you need to have a lot of data. And if you want to have some movement like car operation or kiteboarding trick to be actually learned in the subconsciousness, you need to repeat it hundreds of times and thousands of times being operated at the symbolic or explainable level before it gets hardwired into the subconsciousness. Now let's consider the very simplistic cognitive architecture of a very elementary agent, which is capable of elementary intelligent behavior. And we can imagine the architecture in the following way. So first of all, there is some knowledge base. And the knowledge base may be about the storage of the predicates, and each of the predicate is kind of link in some kind of graph database, and the predicates may be specific to the subject domain. For example, we can, if we have a system that is capable to operate the car, there would be one ontology and one sort of predicates. If you want to have a system which is able to play some game based on the image on the screen, as we will see on the next slide, every predicate will be just a pixel, color of the pixel on every coordinate on the screen. Like, for example, if you have a screen with 8 to 8 pixels, square screen, then you have 64 pixels. And then every pixel, maybe if the screen is white blue, then you have just 64 predicates to describe the all possible images on your screen. So every pixel saturation, either black or white, is a predicate. If you have a color image, then you have thrice more predicates, because every color can be expressed with three different predicates for every pixel, where the predicates for every pixel are saturations of the red, green, and blue colors respectively. So it all, but for universal agent we don't care. For universal agent, all what it has to do, it has to have some system of predicates corresponding to the outer world based on the sensors and actors that are possible present. Like, for example, given simple predicate can either make love or war in respect to outer environment. It can also prospect either war or love, and it can have a feeling being happy. So given this simple ontology, so the only option of the agent is to perceive war or love from the environment. It can respond with love and war, and based on the responses it is given by some feedback from the environment which makes it to feel happy or unhappy. So the happiness is another predicate, okay? And let's imagine the design of this agent, and the design may be containing of the knowledge base, as I said, and the knowledge base may have some have four segments. So the segment number one at the very top is base values, and in fact in most of animals, including humans, these base values are hard-coded from the evolution and they are not learned. That's to be safe, to leave offsprings, to get food, to avoid hunger. And so that's all base values or initial instincts that are possessed by all animals, including humans. At the very bottom, there are two different logs or historical data recordings. So at the very bottom, there is a direct detection log. So that's actually a log of the actions that you perceive, that you perform. So if you want to do something, you have the action written to the action log, and then this action is being executed to the outer environment. But beyond the actions that you perform on your own, there is a log of observed evidence, and that's historical data about all perceptions that you have about the external world. For example, here we have a feeling of war coming from outside, and we are making love and respect to outside world at a later time. Besides that, there is a layer called the layer of the inferred models, and these inferred models are the models that an agent can learn based on the experiences. For example, if I am a worm and if I am trying to crawl, And if I have options to crawl in different directions, and if I learn that crawling into the direction which has which is has a warmer, so let's say you put the warm on some surface with cold on one end and heat on the other end, and let's say the cold is really cold and warm is not that cold, not that warm, so it's not hot, it's just warm. So the worm may be able to try to crawl in different directions, and experientially it might learn that if it crawls in the direction of cold, it gets colder, and if it tries to crawl into the direction of warm, it gets warmer. And let's say that the base values hard-coded into the worm's feedback system is about that warmer is the better for given kind of worm. Maybe there are some worms living in the frost, I don't know, but typical worm expects that it's some conditions with temperature sufficiently above zero by Celsius. So then, given the inferred evidence, observed evidence, the worm may build a model. So if I crawl to the right, to the worm, to the direction of worm, then it gets warmer. And so then it can use this inferred model, so the environment to make their decisions. Like on this example, besides the different sorts of knowledge stored in the system, there are different kinds of activities that an agent can make. So the activity number one in the middle is a predictor. So given observed evidence and partially directed actions, agent can make a predictions. Like if there is a crawling into the worm, if crawl into the direction of worm, then it gets warmer. Or if I am causing love to someone outside of myself, then I am getting happy. And then using this based on these inferred models, the agent can make decisions. Like, for example, at some point of time, the agent may figure out that there is a perception of war coming off outside, and the agent have experience that responding to war with war just makes things worse. But it has another experience that responding to war with love makes things better in given a sort of conditions that agent has been experienced. And so at the moment T1, given agent may decide that responding to war with love is better than to responding to war with war. And so the decision is made and action is sent to the direction, directed action log, and the love is directed towards surrounded world at a later time. But besides these two components, there is a component which I call compressor, and responsibility of the compressor is the need to address the problem of the constrained resources. If you remember the definition of the intelligence, we were talking that the intelligence is ability to work under limited resources. And so if you try to keep all your past experiences in your memory, you will probably have your memory overfilled. And that's not only about the computer memory, that's about human memory as well. So humans are capable to somehow compress what they learn about the outer world into some particular simplified representations. Like every cat on the world becomes just a cat. Every dog on the world becomes just a dog. So you don't remember all specific properties of the dogs or cats that you have been experiencing from your life. But when someone is talking about the cats, you just bring your memories about some abstract cat which is kept in your memory. So the goal of the compressor is just make it possible to limit size of models, number of models, and also there is a possibility that if some of the models involve particular actions too often, You can shortcut your internal thinking processes by moving some of the predicates to base values instead of having them in addition to those that are hard-coded by the supervisor. For example, if making love makes you happy all the time, whenever you make love, you feel happy. If that happens, and if the being happy is your hard-coded base value, then you might save resources and simplify your behavioral schema if you move the making love into the base values. And then the making love becomes your internal goal, not hard-coded by the evolution. That's something that may be thought, you know, what has happened to human society and human culture at some point. Here is example. Here is example of how you would be able to implement this kind of agent using one of the games that are present on OpenAI OpenGym environment. And one of these games is called Atari Breakdown game. So the Atari Breakdown rules are simple. So for those who don't know that, it is like you have the ball, which may be thrown by a rocket, and the ball is a ball, and the ball is reflecting from the walls and from the ceiling, and the ball eventually drops on the floor after the subsequent reflection from either a ceiling or a floor. And the goal of the player is to move the rocket so you can catch the ball before it hits the floor. So if the ball is hitting the floor, you are getting sad. You are punished. Maybe you have electricity striking your fingers or your butt. And if you are happy, you are given some bonuses, you have some nice pictures, you have some nice sound, you may have endorphins injected into your blue blood, or you have some electric signals sent to your centers of your pleasure if you are being an animal placed into the some experimental device made by used by neurophysiologists. So the goal of the agent here is to perceive coordinates of the ball on the X and Y scale, coordinates of the rocket, and perceptions of the sad and happy. Here, the sad and happy are simple predicates because the sad and happy is just either I'm sad or I'm happy, or I'm not sad or I'm not happy. So these are simple predicates. X ball, Y ball, and X rocket here are kind of more like functions because the X ball is a number, but you can always simplify the problem describing the X ball function as just a bunch of predicates describing the ball position, like X zero at moment of time t, x1 at moment of time t, x2 at moment of time t, where the number describes the coordinate of the ball on the screen. So then you can split the functions x ball, y ball, and rocket into the bunch of predicates corresponding to the unit system and coordinates metric system of your screen, or your number given number, or given number of your pixels on the screen if you are playing virtual version of this game. So and finally, given such kind of input, there are two predicates that agent can apply to the outer environment: either move rocket right, or move rocket left, or keep the rocket stay in place. And then the ability of this agent not being explained the rules of the game, but only percepting the inputs of input predicates and trying to respond to the game with the output action log of the output predicates, the agent should be able to succeed in this world. And on the right, you see the very simplistic implementation of this agent able to solve this problem. Like from the very beginning, you see lots on the graphs on the right. You see that a lot of red bars correspond to unsuccessive movements, And each bar on the graphs are corresponding to the moment when the ball is hitting the bottom of the play board. So if there is a red, then that there is a negative feedback. If there is a blue, then that's a positive feedback. And you can see that at the beginning of the game, most of the moves are causing pain and sadness, but closer to the end of the game, every move is successful because the agent is using the evidence and action logs and the models in order to infer the right predictive models and make decisions based on the base values. And the base value here is to avoid pain and maximize the happiness. So here is another example of how you can structure the cognitive architecture more closer to what we have in the human environments. Like at the lower level of cognition, we have different sorts of visual, auditory, tactile, and olfactory perceptions. So you can recognize particular objects like a plane or a bird, particular letters like A in English or in Russian, particular sounds on played by musical instruments, and so forth. At the higher level, you bundle these objects into the single units, like a particular word or particular object consisting of multiple objects, like a flock of birds or brigade of planes. You can also have some combined social interactions like friendship, friendship, love, and so forth. And the very higher level, you deal with the very abstract concepts like any abstract plane or any abstract action. And what is also important is that from the very bottom level to the very higher level, the meanings of every entity perceived at every level is contextual. For example, looking on the image at the bottom left, when you look at these two images, if you really want to see the bird, you would like to see the bird in both of the cases. And if you really like to see the plane, you possibly would be able to see the plane in both of the images. Also, if you look at the two different A's here, it may be either Russian A or English A, depending on what you expect. And so if you are thinking at the higher level of abstraction, if you are thinking about the word act, again, depending on the context and depending on your expectation, it is about treating a word act as a document or a noun, or an act as a deed or a verb. And here is the example of how you can build the multimodal perception and action architecture. And that's example just not complete. For example, we don't have olfactory percepts here, we don't have tactile percepts here, we don't have any movements here. So we are talking about more like higher level cognitive activities like seeing pictures, reading words, reading human speech, and then writing pictures, writing words, and speaking sentences aloud. So what we have on this architecture? First of all, we have different channels. Like we have perception of the images, we have perceptions of the letters, we have perceptions of the sounds. And we have different channels of the output, like pronouncing sentences, writing written text, and rendering some pictures. And in the meaning, in the middle, we have everything blended together. For example, if you are seeing the cat, that's still a cat. If you are hearing the word cat, that's the same cat. If you are reading the word cat in the book, you are imagining the same cat as you typically imagined to deal with. If you see a word cat and you see the image of the cat above the word, and if you hear the word cat, which is being pronounced to you by your mother or by your teacher who is teaching you to read, then you have blended or mutually grounded meanings of a cat based on multiple channels of perception. And also, if you learn how to drive the car, then you may be reading the handbook, and there may be some images of how you turn the engine on, some illustrations like a hand pressing the clicking the key, and the leg pressing the gas pedal, and the hand pulling the handle. So that there may be illustrations, but there may be also a text explaining the order of events, and there also may be instructor teaching you aloud how to start your car, providing verbal explanations to the schema that you perceive by your eyes at the same time, or by the or sitting inside of the car. So besides grounding and assembling all these meanings in the middle, you have the expectations, and based on what you perceive at the given moment of time, you direct your expectations to your perceptions above. So if you for example, if I'm speaking to you in English during the most of the previous talk, then you expect that I would keep speaking in English by the end of this talk. And if I switch to Russian suddenly, you will be confused, because before you realize that I'm speaking Russian, you will be under impression that you just don't clearly understand the words that I'm saying. But you will adapt soon, of course, but initially you would have some confusion, and you will need to change your behavioral program from English language interpretation to Russian language interpretation. And also, when you direct some action towards the outer world, writing the images or rendering some pictures, you also have feedback control from your muscles that making you sure about your do everything right. And finally, there is experiential feedback coming. So for example, when you write the word cat, then there is a mother saying that, okay son, that's a word cat written in the right way. So you have the experiential environmental feedback coming from the outer world, and it can come by voice, it can be if you are speaking with your mother or teacher, or it can be in a chat. If you are being trained over the chat channel, it can be anything. Another interesting aspect of the processing that is happening along the way within this cognitive architecture is multi-layer transformation of complexity. So let's say we are doing the character recognition and character generation, and by means of perceiving the input speech and generating the input speech in written form or in a spoken form. So let's consider that we are dealing with a spoken form. So first of all, you expect that images or symbols or words are meaning something in one particular language. If you are expecting to read the Russian, then letter A would be interpreted as A. If you are expected to read English, the letter A will be experienced as letter A. And then at some layer you read strokes, then you assemble strokes into letters, then you assemble letters into words, then you assemble words into the sentences, and on each level of such transformation, you do the transformation of the structure of the information from a kind of representation and one dimensionality to another dimensionality. For example, if you have characters or letters encoded in matrices of 16 to 16 pixels, then amount of predicates that you have is 286 pixels, right? Assuming that we have a black and white scheme. But using these 25 pixels, you can represent 23 characters or hieroglyphs in Chinese. So you translate the space of 26 predicates into the which can appear all together at once to the space of 23 predicates, where each predicate is a symbol, but only one can appear at one time. So from one point of view, that's reduction of complexity, because every picture is getting associated with one specific symbol. So you turn 285 pixels, we transformed 225 pixels into the single character. But on the other hand, that's increase of the complexity, because using this combination of 256 pixels, you can generate 23,000 of characters, and that's increase of the complexity. And everything happens, and that transformation of complexity happens on every layer. You the number, all possibilities of words is reduced to possible combinations of letters. So the limited number of words can be built from the limited number of characters. And but the amount of different combinations is gradually increased. So using 23,000 characters, you can build 370,000 of words. And then you can generate infinite number of sentences, where each sentence is actually associating words, which are represented built from characters, and characters are built from individual strokes. And similarly, you can do all the same forward. When you direct action toward the environments, you gain, you transform the complexity in one form into the complexity on the another form. What I called mutual grounding is not happening at the middle. So if you have multi-layer channels of perception accordingly to different modalities, when you are saying that you blend them or ground them each in respect to other at the very abstract level, that's not true, because the ground, mutual grounding and assemble of the associations across multiple modalities may be happening all the way from the higher lower level of perception to higher level of perception. And the same picture can be drawn in respect to the case when you generate the action to direct towards the environments. For example, consider the perception on the walking and mewing cat. First of all, you can see some color pixels, and you assemble these pixels, and you are seeing objects or particular features of the objects, like you are seeing the ears, paws, tail, and you assemble these ears, paws, and the tail into the single cat. But then you can also read letters and strokes and build the letters from the strokes, and you assemble the word cat from the letters. But then you also hear some pitches of the sound, and these pitches are assembled into the sounds, and the sounds are assembled into the words, like a word cat. So you see the cat, you read the cat, and you hear the cat. But you also have an odor feeling capability, and you smell the smell of a cat. And then you take your hand towards the cat, and you feel the soft fur, and you can also realize that that's a cat according to your tactile experiences. But when you see the cat, and you hear the cat, and you read the word cat at the same time, you can already assemble the single unite meaning of the cat at the level of the individual word. But then later you see that the cat is moving within the space, you recognize the scene of the moving cat or walking cat. If you read the sentence, you see that that's still indeed a cat. And if you hear the sentence, that's if you hear the sentence saying by your mother, it's a cat, you also realize a cat. But then you can also hear the mewing sound coming from the cat. It is not shown in the picture, unfortunately. You can realize that the overall impression directed to your senses across multimodal perception channels is that this particular walking cat is actually mewing at the time. And that's the way how the hierarchical multilayer perception can let you get more abstract concepts at the higher level. Now let's see what we can do about these graph representations and different sources of cognitive activities, like we were talking about subconscious thinking, where we think fast but we train low, and consciousness, higher level activity, when we think slow but we learn fast. Let's imagine some imaginary system of the image recognition where we can train our artificial neural network to recognize the horses. And then we can dive into the imaginary neural network, and then we can figure out that some neurons are connected to the neurons in the upper layer in such a way that whenever any neuron at a higher level is activated, like for example, if the neuron responsible for the black color identification is firing, or the neuron responsible for the brown color identification is firing, then you have the concept of the horse always activated at the same time. So that means that black and brown are all properties of the horse. And we can guess that these are about such a property of a horse as a color. Or it may be black and white at the same time, and then that's still a horse of specific kind. It's a zebra, right? So then you can derive that color of a horse may be a logical disjunction or expression or predicate uniting given colors, no matter whether the horse is white or black or brown, it is still recognized as a horse, but it can't be red. So that the conjunction will be the conjunction of white, black and brown. On the other hand, you may find the different features of the object, like physical properties of the horse's body, like hooves. You can find that this particular or a tail. You can find that these properties are all required for horse to be a horse, like having hooves or having a tail, all necessary to identify the object as a horse. And then if you look in this from the neural network connection weights perspective, you may find that in order to be part of the body of the object to be identified as a horse, it has to have such features like a hooves or a tail present both. And then that's a logical conjunction. Yeah, sorry. Okay, I misused the conjunction and disjunction. So color is disjunction, because the disjunction is about or, and the hooves and tail is conjunction, because it's about and. So in the end, we can get see the logical formula here in the end. So we can see that the horse have to have both expected shapes and expected color. And in order for neuron responsible for horse to be activated or fired here, we need to have sufficient amount of weights involved into transmitting signal from the neuron responsible for shape, layer responsible for shape, and part of the layer responsible for color. So here we have conjunction of the property and the color. And at the upper layer we have disjunction or logical or operation in respect to brown color and white and black color. So that's logical disjunction. And the conjunction of disjunctions may be recorded as a conjunctive normal form. The difference of this conjunctive normal form that we can see in the neural network is that it is not a conjunctive normal form built of conjunctions and disjunctions in terms of plain logic, because we don't have if then else here. We have just weights in the neural connections, and the weights may reside in range from 0 to 1, so they are fuzzy, or they can be expressed in terms of probabilistic or Bayesian or fuzzy logic that we have been discussing earlier today. But what's important here is that if you are able to find this kind of knowledge in a neural network model theoretically, you can potentially extract this knowledge to the logical representation where the same knowledge is written in terms of predicates. And then you have the conjunction and about hoofs and tail. You have a conjunction about being white and black at the same time, so we can recognize the zebra. And you have a disjunction of white and black zebra and brown horse, so you can have the expected color describing either a zebra horse or some kind of brown horse. Also, of course, you can see another, you can add another argument here, another possibility here. It may be just completely white horse, or it may be completely the black horse, but I didn't put it here just to order to keep the picture simpler. So in the end, you just unite the expected shapes and expected color all together using the AND expression of the conjunction, and you get the logical formula representing conjunctive normal form is plain logic. And finally, of course, you can also, if you have these fuzzy or probabilistic weights present in the neural model, you can also place these probability values or truth values attaching them to the links, so you have this system of predicates describing the knowledge in a probabilistic or non-axiomatic way. Here is the same similar example where we can describe the and by the way, when you explain the model of the knowledge in such a reasonable way, you then further fix this model if it has some mistakes, or you can also solve the problem of the transfer learning, uploading this model into some other neural network that you don't want to train from the very beginning. If you have managed to learn recognition of the cats, dogs, horses, and cows, and if you need a system which is capable to recognize only the horses and the cows, and you don't need to care about cats and dogs, what you can do, you can extract the knowledge from the neural network model. Then you can remove all species that you don't need in your recognition in production, and then you can upload this model back to your neural network system, and then the system would be able to do fast recognitions in respect only the objects that are uploaded there. Just imaginary business case. And so the same you can do, the same logic and reasoning you can apply to the natural language processing, as we discussed on the video yesterday. So you can describe the model and the linguistic model in the neural network, or you can explicitly describe this model where each layer in a symbolic explainable interpretation, where each layer of the model will be corresponding either to particular words or to particular categories of words or to particular kinds of links connecting the words or to particular conjunctions of the links into assemblies of the grammatical links building the structure of the sentence, which is called as a disjunct and being assembled in the conjunction which takes all possible disjuncts for a given category of a word, such a noun. So here we need to break, and let's see, actually Yeah, here we need to break, and on the next talk we'll be talk more about different ways how we can build such a systems and different approaches that are taken in the industry. And finally, we move on to the actual structures of the data representations in graph and metagraphs that can be employed in production. So thank you.